الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه أما بعد We touch upon the hadith number 4, inshallah, in al-hadith al-Nawawiyyah. And today's hadith is an Abdullah ibn Umar, radiyallahu anhuma, an al-Nabiyyi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, annahu qal, bunya al-Islamu ala khams, shahadati an la ilaha illallah, wa anna Muhammad rasulullah, wa iqam al-salah, wa ita' al-zakah, wa al-hajj, wa sawmu Ramadan. In this hadith, which is narrated by Sahih Muslim and Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ tells us that Islam is built upon 5 pillars. And from every word that the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned in this hadith, there are many lessons and there are many words of wisdom that we need to understand and follow. The Prophet ﷺ here says, Buniya, Mabni lil Majhul, means that he does not say, I built Islam. He does not say, Islam will be built, but he either said that Islam was built, which means that somebody built this deen upon these 5 pillars, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not a legislator, but rather he's a prophet, he's a messenger, and he's conveying on behalf of his Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here he says, Buniya al-Islam. And we all heard of the word Islam, alhamdulillah we are Muslims, and we have 2 different types of Islam. And that may come as a surprise to some of you, but it shouldn't really. The Islam that is mentioned in this hadith, the scholars refer to as an Islam al-Khas, is that specific type of Islam that our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has come with. Al-Islam al-Am is basically the Islam that all the prophets and the messengers and their followers have adhered to. So Al-Islam al-Am consists of what? Tawheed. So they all have the same aqeedah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. He is unlike any others of His creation. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ Nothing resembles Him. We cannot give examples to how He may look like, how His actions may take place, how He may hear, see, know, or any of that. So this is the concept of Tawheed in Islam in a nutshell. Then we, Tawheed al-Ta'a wal-Inqiyad means that we listen and we obey exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. And that means al-Istislam, to surrender, and to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all that He has legislated. And then thirdly is al-bara'a min ash-shirk, to declare our innocence from any shirk whatsoever. Meaning that when we render our ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we render every act of ibadah. And ibadah by definition is kullu qawlin wa amal, every words and deeds, be it the deeds of the tongue, the deeds of the heart, or the deeds of the rest of the limbs. يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَيَرْضَاهُ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, accepts from us, and rewards us for. So all of these ibadat that can only be disposed of to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be disposed of to any other entity whatsoever. Any act of worshipping or disposing any of these ibadat in part or in whole to any other entity, along with or aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an act of shirk that negates all of one's deeds. Negates all of one's deeds. So these 3 elements again is at-tawheed, al-bara'a min ash-shirk, and then obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala infinitely to the best of our abilities. So this is al-Islam al-Am, this is the Islam that every prophet and every messenger has followed. With minor differences in the aqeedah, as we know the aqeedah entails 6 different pillars, which is al-Iman billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawm al-akhir wa al-qada' khayru wa sharru. So when it comes to the fundamental aspects of the pillars of Iman, they all believed in the same exact fundamental aspects of the pillars of Iman. But when it comes to the branches, there has been some slight differences. In other words, there were some divine revelations at the time of Dawood alayhi salam that were not present, so he was not obligated to believe in that. There were some prophets and messengers that have not been sent yet, so therefore they're not obligated to, you know, obey them or follow them. So here, these are like the branches, but in the collective sense of the word, Islam means to conduct or to adopt the tawheed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from us, to surrender all other ideologies, as he says in the Quran, فَمَن يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ. So we cannot adhere to or hold on to any preconceived notions in our creed, and then add to that the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, we must come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a clean slate, negating all ideologies and then embracing Islam under the concept of Tawheed. Okay? So that's what all the prophets and the messengers have come with, and that's known as al-Islam al-Am. But what we're talking about in this hadith, what the Prophet ﷺ is referring to, is the specific type of Islam that is described in this hadith and described in the Quran and other ahadith as well. So therefore, for example, the salah that we perform is not the same salah that every other prophet and messenger and their followers have performed. Their salah was slightly different. They did not recite from the Quran because the Quran was not revealed. So their salah was different. The siyam was also different. We fast the month of Ramadan. The narrations of the hadith and the collective opinion or the majority opinion of the scholars that included Tafsir ibn Kathir and others, they say that people have fasted 3 days out of every month. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ did at the outset of the message. This is what he did in Mecca, and this is what he did for 20 some months in Medina, that he would fast 3 days out of every month until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated that we as the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have this different legislation when it comes to Salah and Siyam and Hajj and Zakah, and this legislation is mentioned in the Quran in general. And in the hadith in details, as the Prophet ﷺ tells us, خُذُوا مَنَاسِكَكُمْ عَنِّي, take your acts of worship from me. Take your acts of worship from me. And we're going to emphasize on that when we talk about the second part of Tawheed. So the first pillar that Islam is built upon is شَهَادَةُ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That entails two parts. Negation. أَلَّا means there is absolutely none worthy of worship and rightfully worship. And then we cannot stop here. So we must add the second one to it. La ilaha illallah means none is worthy or rightfully worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because none has created and has absolute ownership of the dominion of the heavens and the earth and all that's in between except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore none can be rightfully worshipped and submitted to and surrendered to but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the one and the only one lawful entity to be worshipped. Wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Muhammad Rasulullah, here we're talking about Muhammad ibn Abdullah al-Qurayshi, al-Makki. Means that he's from Quraysh, he's from Mecca. This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is the seal prophet of all prophets, 124,000 prophets and messengers throughout the history of mankind. And that means he's also one of the mighty prophets that are mentioned in the Quran. Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only he is one of the mighty prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the number one, the master of all prophets. He is the number one man. He is the master of the children of Adam. As he says in the hadith, in the authentic hadith, أنا سيد بني آدم ولا فخر. I am the master of the children of Adam, and I am not boasting or bragging about it. He is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded to, establish the salah, the nafila, qiyam al-layl, half of the night, one third of it, a little more, a little less. عَسَى رَبُّكَ أَن يَبْعَثَكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you this praised position, which is the position and the status of Shafa'ah on Judgment Day, as we read in the hadith, that he's the one that everyone will go to, ultimately every Muslim will go to, in order to intercede on their behalf in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he prostrate himself in front of the Arsh and ask for Shafa'ah for the Muslims. Wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, that everything that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come with is the absolute truth. That he does not speak out of his own opinions or imagination or any of that. That he must be infinitely obeyed. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, مَن يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهُ. Whoever obeys the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has indeed obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyone who says the Quran is sufficient, we don't need to follow the Sunnah, this person has exited the state of Islam. Because the one who brought the Quran is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Quran itself says, obey the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam infinitely. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. The word ta'a, obedience, is mentioned before the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to indicate that we obey Him infinitely. And the word ta'a is again mentioned in front of the name of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to indicate that we must obey him infinitely. The word ta'a is not mentioned in front of ulil amr. Why? Because Abu Bakr, who is the second man to walk the face of the earth, to have the most knowledge on the face of the earth after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, أَطِيعُونِي مَا أَطَعْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Obey me so long that I am obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِنْ عَصَيْتُهُ فَلَا طَاعَةَ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ. I am telling you right off, you know, up front, that I am not ma'soom. I am not protected from making errors in matters of the sharia. I am a human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the asma, the protection from making errors in matters of the sharia, to the prophets and the messengers. Nobody else. So everybody else is fallible. And here the understanding of this faqih, the faqih of the ummah, Abu Bakr, he says, obey me so long that I'm in obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِنْ عَصَيْتُهُ, if I'm in to act in any way ignorantly and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there is no obligation upon you to obey me. There is no obligation upon you to obey me. This is the understanding of the faqih of the ummah, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Add more to that, and this is like a word of caution. Oftentimes when we learn at the hands of a scholar, be it a family member, be it, you know, a colleague, be it somebody who is of high caliber, oftentimes we begin to say, so-and-so said this, and so-and-so expressed this opinion in the deen, and so-and-so. And then we forget that there is something called Quran, and there's something called Sunnah. Quran and Sunnah. So even though sometimes you will find that a scholar would make an error and would speak in matters where his opinion is weak or his opinion is not rightfully founded, and then we continue to basically refer to this scholar or to this person, Imam of a Masjid or any person, you know, for that matter, what we have done is that we have not rightfully followed the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because we are not referring to him. We don't say قال الله وقال الرسول. These are the things that we must get used to, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, authenticating that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did say that in the Quran, and authenticating that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did say that in the authentic hadith, and it's not a weak hadith, and it's not a hadith that is mawdu', that is unauthentic, or it's not even a hadith altogether. And we hear these statements all the time. And just a word of caution, when we speak about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and relate information of religious nature on his behalf, we must authenticate this information. Because the hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, al-kadhibu alayya laysa kal-kadhibi ala ghayri aw ala ahadin ghayri, means that to say that I said and you're lying, it's not like saying that somebody else said and you're lying. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is relating the very most important, you know, legislation of all, and that is the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth and all that's in between. And similarly in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, man kadaba alayya amidan falyatabawwa maq'adahu min an-nar, that whoever fabricates a lie against me, let them anticipate, deliberately that is, let them anticipate their place in the hellfire. Now sometimes we negligently do that, and that could, part of the wa'id, part of the threat could apply to us. So we must authenticate whatever a hadith that we attempt to narrate on behalf of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan rasulullah, and that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the sealed messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which also entails that anyone try to pretend that they're a prophet or they're a messenger, or to believe in another prophet or a messenger, we come and say you have exited the state of Islam because you have not even fulfilled the first pillar of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is to bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah alayhi salatu wasalam is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is also the sealed messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, in general, we believe that all the prophets and the messengers are infallible in matters of the sharia, that they are infallible in matter of the, you know, the human character, that they are not people who would commit, you know, the large sins or any of that, that they're role models for all humanity, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his infinite knowledge and wisdom, he selected them to be our role models. So they are infallible in that respect. They are infallible in that respect. Shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan rasulullah, وإقام الصلاة. Of course, the shahada, as we mentioned, it entails that you must have knowledge of that which you are given testimony for. So when I say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, the question is, what do I know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bear witness that none is rightfully worshipped but Him? And when I say أشهد أن محمد رسول الله, what do I know about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to bear witness that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So I must have knowledge in order to give, you know, my testimony. Second, I must apply that which I am given testimony about. Means that I need to learn the Quran, I need to learn the Sunnah, I need to learn the Ibadat, and then I must, you know, follow through with ta'a and inqiyad, obedience and following. Okay? And thirdly, I must propagate the message of Islam, because it's an obligation. The Prophet ﷺ says, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ بِآيَةٍ. So as a witness, I am commanded, I have witnessed that the Prophet ﷺ has said that. That he has said, convey on my behalf even with one ayah. Even by just saying, La ilaha illallah. Even by saying, mentioning a name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An ayah in the Quran, a hadith upon the Prophet ﷺ. And this is readily manifested in the hadith when the Prophet ﷺ sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal. And he said, you come upon a group of the people of the book, and the first thing you tell them, La ilaha illallah. And we all know that the heavens and the earth and all that's in existence has been created for the purpose of La ilaha illallah. So we cannot underestimate what this testimony means. And then, of course, you know, in the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said, if they accept that from you, by the way, La ilaha illallah entails Muhammadun Rasulullah. So if it's mentioned by itself, it entails Muhammadun Rasulullah. And if it's not, if it's mentioned together, then each are separate. One has an indication, La ilaha illallah, talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, and the other one talks about his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what he had come to convey. So I believe that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not speak by way of his own imagination or whims and desires or opinions or any of that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He does not speak by way of his own thinking, إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He is indeed receiving this knowledge by way of the wahy. And when we talk about the wahy, just a bit added information, because it's also an integral part of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believing in his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we must understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means by saying, وَمَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُكَلِّمَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا وَحْيًا. It is not the case that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would speak to anyone who is a prophet or a messenger or otherwise, except by way of the wahy. The way of the wahy here, we know who is Amin al-Sama, the trustee of the heavens, is Jibreel alayhi salam, who delivered the message or the messages to all the respective prophets and the messengers. وَمَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُكَلِّمَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا وَحْيًا أَوْ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ. Or behind, from a behind, a barrier. Just like he spoke to Musa alayhi salam, and then Musa alayhi salam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to him. Of course, we cannot go into details as to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks and how Musa alayhi salam heard, or any of that. That is knowledge of the unknown that is only privy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أو من وراء حجاب, or from behind a barrier, just like he spoke to Musa. أو يرسل رسولا فيوحي بإذنه ما يشاء. Or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send a messenger, and then he reveals or gives wahi to the messenger in ways that are appropriate for this messenger and for the status and the majesty and the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the second pillar, وإقام الصلاة. So here it tells us that إقام الصلاة, establishing the salah, just like establishing all the other pillars of Islam, first and foremost we must establish our iman. And if we cannot establish the iman, one can pray day and night, it will not be accepted from them. One can perform the hajj every year, can perform the umrah every day if you will, okay? Can perform any ibadah they wish consistently, and it will not be accepted from them. Because all of the ibadat are established by establishing the aqeedah of the Muslim. The aqeedah of the Muslim that is consistent with the aqeedah of the Prophet ﷺ is a prerequisite for the acceptance of any deed whatsoever. That's prerequisite number one. Prerequisite number two is what we mentioned in the hadith, خُذُوا مَنَاسِكَكُمْ عَنِّي. Pray like you saw me pray. Fast like you saw me fast. Give zakah like you saw me give zakah. Perform the hajj and all the other ibadah, just like the way the Prophet ﷺ performed the ibadah. And we know that the worst of matters that we hear in every Friday khutbah that is mentioned in the hadith, that the Prophet ﷺ used to say on the member, وَإِنَّ شَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. The worst of matters are deliberate attempts to change and alter the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as they are acts of misguidance, as it is a fabricated lie or lies against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they are ultimately doomed to the hellfire, and they shall be responsible for that bid'ah and for everyone who followed them in that bid'ah. So not only are they responsible for their own bid'ah and their own misguidance, but they're also responsible for the bid'ah and the misguidance of everyone who followed and performed that bid'ah, whether they are alive or they're dead. He said they could die and go away, their file is not closed. Anyone who continues to perform these bid'ah will, you know, carry, this person will carry a share of it. Just like when Qabil killed Habil. Qabil gets an equivalent sin for everyone who commits a murder on the face of the earth, because it was an invented crime. It was an invented crime. وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ. When we talk about the salah, the scholarly opinion, and that's a collective scholarly opinion, that anyone who deliberately leaves salah out of their ibadah is a kafir, has exited the state of Islam. The area of dispute among them, one who deliberately left it, that's ijma', that they are collectively saying that this person has exited the state of Islam. Where they disagree is if this person left the salah out of laziness, not giving it its due attention. And they divide themselves into two different groups. One says, even if they leave it, you know, out of negligence or recklessness or any other reason, they're still considered a kafir, an apostate, meaning that, you know, this person has exited the state of Islam, and the evidence that they based their fatwa on, قول الله عز وجل, قالوا ما سلككم في سقر, قالوا لم نكن من المصلين. When the angels ask people who, you know, the disbelievers who enter this place in Saqar. Saqar is, wa'iyadu billah, is a deep valley in the hellfire. They said, what landed you in this deep valley in the hellfire? They said, the first reason, lam nakum min al-musalleen. We did not pray. We did not pray. Now, the group that they say, if they leave it out of negligence or laziness, that they said this person is not a kafir, they also collectively say that this person is a corrupt, that this person is a fasiq, is corrupt, and he or she deserved the punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them. So they're not saying that this person is a-okay, absolutely not. And that applies to all the other ibadah. But more specifically the salah, because in the hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, رَأْسُ الْأَمْرُ الْإِسْلَامِ, the head of the matter is Islam. And the backbone of it is as-salah. So can you imagine a living being without a backbone? Can't, be a crippled person. And the Sahaba collectively agreed that they did not consider anyone to be a kafir after embracing Islam except one who left the salah. So that's a collective opinion among, you know, the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, which makes it a hujjah, a clear evidence that their opinion is correct. وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ. And of course, this is the salah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, that establishing this salah that is backed by Iman, and that is entailing all the arkan, the pillars of salah, and the sunan, and achieving the khushu' in that salah, this is the salah that is going to forbid you from attaining al-fahsha, the greater form of sin, wal-munkar, that which is prohibited and rejected by the sharia. The exercises that some people do, it's not going to help them any in staying away from sinful behavior. It's not going to help them any. And they will receive absolutely no credit for it, because the Prophet ﷺ tells us that one salah, the credit they receive for their salah is proportionate to their khushu'. So the amount of khushu' you achieve in your salah is the amount of reward that you're going to collect. So if one comes on judgment day where the salah is deficient because they did not achieve khushu', Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, look into my abd's nawafil. Perhaps he or she has performed nawafil that can make up for the obligatory salah that is short or that is deficient. And if the nawafil makes up for it, then be it. They get the full credit for it. If the nawafil do not make up for it, then this person is in trouble. This person is in serious trouble. Iqam al-salah, ita' al-zakah. So salah is purely physical and spiritual act of ibadah. Ita' al-zakah, zakah is purely monetary ibadah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated the zakah. Of course, it's a pillar of Islam, so we don't justify the legislation by understanding the wisdom. Whether we understand the wisdom or not, we must perform, we must pay our zakah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches from the wisdom behind the legislation of the zakah, as he says in Surah Al-Hadid, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. This is really the objective of zakah. One is that to prevent us and protect us from the stinginess within us. And many of the scholars said that the human being is born attached to the wealth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to separate, you know, this human being, this Muslim, this believer, from that which they are physically attached to, and attach them to that which is spiritual. Attach them to that which is divine, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one wisdom that we understand. The second, that it's a right for the poor in the wealth of the wealthy. So this way, it brings yani, the believing society together as one unit. So the wealthy is not going to look down at the poor and neglect them. And the poor is not going to be envious and jealous and hateful of the wealthy, because they don't have the means to live and the wealthy is living lavishly. So this brings the society together, of course, in addition to many other wisdoms that you know we can talk about later, inshallah. إقام الصلاة إيتاء الزكاة والحج. And of course, al-hajj here, of course, is also a matter of dispute among the scholars as to, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligated those who gave the testimony of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah to perform hajj once in a lifetime when they have the means financially and the access physically to go and perform the hajj. And of course, there's a lot of dispute whether how quickly should I perform the hajj, can I wait when the means are available. You know, the opinion that seems to be rather, you know, compromises between the two sides, حُجُّ قَبْلَ أَن لَا تَحُجُّ. Perform the hajj while you can. Can't guarantee that next year you'll have the wealth. Cannot guarantee that next year you'll have the health. Cannot guarantee next year you'll have the access to Mecca. Cannot guarantee that next year you'll be alive. So therefore, as soon as you get that opportunity to perform the hajj, hasten towards performing the hajj, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَرَحْمَةٍ. Hasten towards an act of forgiveness, an expiation of sins from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And similarly, when Musa alayhi salam went to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he asked him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, وَمَا أَعْجَلَكَ عَنْ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى. What have made you leave your people and hasten towards this meeting? قَالَ عَجِلْتُ إِلَيْكَ رَبِّي لِتَرْضَى. He said, oh Allah, I've hastened toward you, so you're pleased with me. So this is what we do with the ibadat. We hasten towards the salah, and towards the siyam, and towards paying our zakah, and pay it with good, you know, with good heart. That this is a ibadah, this is a qurba, an act that will bring me closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he said in the hadith, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِأَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَطُوا عَلَيْهِ. It is never the case that my abd, my slave, can come close to me, except first and foremost with the obligatory acts of worship. So we do not start with the nawafil, we start with the obligatory acts. وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهِ. Then we move on to the nawafil, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves us, as the hadith tells us. وَالْحَجْ وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاءِ. And then, of course, وَصَوْمُ رَمَضَانِ. Pardon me, this is the last one. وَصَوْمُ رَمَضَانِ, which is, you know, fasting the month of Ramadan, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that upon us, and as he tells us at the outset of these ayat that speak about Ramadan, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. All you who believe, similarly to other ibadat, that fasting is decreed upon you, just like it was decreed upon prior believing nations, so that you would achieve that concept of taqwa. And this is all we need to take with us when we part ways with this journey, the journey of life, the lower form of life as we know it, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. And make sure you have plenty sustenance with you when you leave this journey. وَخَيْرُ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. The best of sustenance you can take with you is taqwa, nothing else. وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. And have taqwa towards me, all people of intellect. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُ بِحَمْدِكَ نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.